Hello.
Hi.
I'm Dina. This is Emily.
I'm Emily.
So we're going to walk you guys through our latest report that we produced in collaboration with Box 1824, which is now, after this speech, available online for download. So K-Hole is a trend forecasting report made between Emily and I, Sean Monahan, Greg, and Greg Fong, and Chris Sharon. We're based out of New York, and we've been releasing our reports as freely downloadable PDFs circulating equally between the arenas of art and marketing. We all have backgrounds in art, but have kind of been negotiating, working in a commercial context. We were working on this report with Box 1824, which is a Sao Paulo-based global research office focused on mapping trends and consumer insights. We met them at DLD in Munich at the 89 Plus panel. And decided to kind of start working together because from K-Hole's point of view on emergent trends and Box's experiences, looking the way that youth culture influences consumption, their 1824 refers to the age demographic that they're addressing. We decided that generational branding and youth marketing was a good thing for us to be taking up in this report.
And beyond that, both groups started in a somewhat similar way. Both started super young as a group of friends, dealing with markets and disciplines like marketing and consumer research, but taking a completely different approach to how those things actually got done, where there was no real distance between the person doing the studying and the person being studied. So basically, neither Box nor K-Hole has any critical distance whatsoever, and that's something that made us like each other and want to work together.
These are our logos.
Those are our logos. So, the death of age. Age is dead. This is the first statement in our report, Youth Mode. And basically, when we sat down to talk about generational branding, what came up was that it seemed like generational branding is about society figuring out how to express its anxieties, figuring out if the kids are all right, is usually figuring out what's at play, what's worrying us and keeping us up at night. And one thing that we kept coming around to was how this cliche about how millennials think they're so special. And it tipped us off to the idea that being special was a rite of passage in terms of being young. Establishing your individuality is how we sort of think about what it means to be a young person. At the same time, being part of a generation kind of strips you of individuality to begin with, because you're part of your generation whether you like it or not, and you can never be fully responsible for what your generation means. So there's already a funny bit of interplay there. So basically, in this report, we're looking at being special and being free as issues of being young, and we're mapping out what's at play in what we're seeing as a crisis of being special that affects everyone, regardless of generational linearity, regardless of age.
So we decided to speak about this. The name of the report is Youth Mode, looking at youth as not corresponding to a numerical age, but kind of as a way of being, but also at the same time not taking that as like an older, you know, numerically older crowd, being like, oh, well, I just need to relive my youth. Or just act like a kid, or just hit rewind, because really, it's more about a preoccupation with freedom, and these are things that end up kind of affecting you at any age, wanting to be emancipated from boredom, seeking potentiality in any situation, engaging with newness, being critical of the past, whether or not you were active or had a role in playing in it, kind of negotiating your individuality in relationship to a group, but also kind of being down with hanging out in groups, being rebellious and being free. But at the same time, youth and this kind of ageless youth understands it not as being limitless, but as having like clearly sort of demarcated walls that you're gonna end up running up against. So
freedom within limits.
Being non-static and adaptable.
We love rules sometimes.
And being able to kind of like negotiate against up these limits is kind of the path to freedom. But ultimately, this kind of like youthful liberation is about having the ability to radically realign yourself with the outside world. So we started thinking about what is this kind of age that we're living in right now. And looking at it not really as like clearly defined dates in the way that people look at Gen X generations is, you know, having very exact lifespan start and finish times, but this is just kind of like our overarching contemporary scenario that we're in.
Yeah, everybody here is mass indie.
Whether you like it or not.
Don't have a choice. We're all mass indie.
And what makes you mass indie is that everybody, you know, dealing with this right now, is trying to put their individuality into formation based on difference. And it's about celebrating difference, and the anxiety that comes with it is that you're kind of failing at that, and that you're not special enough. And we've been kind of getting this passed down from, you know, the 60s and 70s, and it's like, what, you know, what's like the ultimate worst is just being like white bread, bland, whatever.
Boring. Unacceptable.
But
uninteresting.
What Mass Indie does is it makes the project of differentiation to a group activity. You know, we're all trying to be different together as, you know, looking out on this crowd, pretty, you know, in your face. So Mass Indie's approach to authenticity is a race to find one's own authenticity. And it still kind of takes up this issue of like being real or being fake, you know, being a part of the mass or being a special snowflake. But what ends up happening is when everybody's trying to be different, these differentiations just get smaller and smaller, and you run into like HD problems.
So basically, mass indie is pro-diversity, but that doesn't mean it's post-scarcity. So everyone's running after more and more markers of authenticity to show that they're special and different.
But there's only so many that you can get. You know,
right, without things getting really weird. And so when they get weird is what happens, what we're calling mass indie problems. Some of you might be experiencing these at the moment. So the first one we call seeming like a clone. So the things that you're doing are so to make yourself differentiate yourself are so small that you end up looking like everybody else. So the name of your startup sounds like everyone else's startup. Your expensive line dry only white t-shirt looks like everyone else's cheap or expensive white t-shirt. That the sort of high resolution quality of what it means to have a lifestyle and an identity in a person actually paradoxically, it's like when an HD TV makes everything look like a BBC original, weirdly. That's
called the soap opera effect.
The soap opera effect, yeah. So that's problem
very
one.
Very dramatic.
Seeming like a clone. Problem two is isolation. So you're so special and so specific that nobody knows what you're talking about. We all know people like that.
Conversation of one, PhD yeah. students.
Yeah, that type of thing. And then problem three is maxing out. So that the what happens when the things that make you special change so quickly and so fast that it's impossible to keep up, and you're in this like constant interplay between.
And this is when people talk about the internet.
FOMO on the internet and in real life, fear of missing out. You have to be in this like fear of missing out zone or this DGAF don't give a fuck zone, and you have to like be between them constantly.
Because you can't just be one or else you're just perennially depressed.
Right, and the only people who don't have this problem are idiot savants.
Who just show up at the right place at the right time.
Yeah, they can't
help
it.
Which sometimes, you know, you can do
that. So those are three examples of mass indie problems. There are also other mass indie problems, but those are favorites. And nope, go back.
All right.
So basically we started thinking about like, what's the way out of this? Not the way out in the sense of like, how do you get outside the system and create something completely new, but how do we actually start thinking about these issues in a new way that makes things loosen up, get more fun, and actually allow for some real cultural innovation or at least less boring behavior?
Because if there's a problem, then obviously there's just a clear opposite solution, obviously.
But what we've seen, and even some of us have done, is what we're calling acting basic, which is like an attempt in mass indie to get out of mass indie, where you start thinking about how being boring is the least appealing thing, paradoxically makes it ripe for the mass indie elites to take on as their own. Because in mass indie, being cool is all about finding more and more difference and neutralizing it by making it your own, bringing everything into the system. So this is how like everyone wants a uniform, or how like fashion designers at the end of their runway shows often look very schlubby, because they're like, oh, we get it. We're gonna be really boring because that's the hardest and scariest thing. And to show that we have really, really high intelligence about how to be cool, we're not even going to have to show how to be cool on the surface.
And the way that, you know, you're kind of playing it cool is by being like, oh, well, I was never even trying to be different in the first place. Like, I can produce a really radical fashion line, but, you know, what else? So the logical, the acting basic reaction to this is like, oh, I'll just make a 180. Like, I'll just take, you know, it has a very linear progression of how identity comes into formation. You know, you buy fair trade coffee, and then you're vegetarian, and then you're vegan, and then you're, I don't know. So just kind of backtrack about it. It's like, I just want to go pre-free trade
coffee.
Yeah,
I want to go pre-mass indie. But honestly, it doesn't really work because you end up stalling. Attempting to master sameness, attempting to play at being as normal as possible, is still using the greater logic of a difference-based coolness in mass indie. And so you end up stalling. A good example of this is this theory that guys stop their style the last time they were really getting laid, which is why like a lot of guys wear cargo shorts a lot. That's like you think like, okay, I can just freeze frame. I can just pick this moment when things were working before everything was changing around me, and I can just go there and stay there.
But what this is doing is thinking that acting basic is just denying complexity and kind of like whitewashing over it, and doesn't really solve it. It's just kind of like khakied. But acting basic isn't a solution to mass indie because it's still based on this dichotomy of difference. It's like, oh, well, you know, mass indie is about being different, then I'll just be the same, and it's solved. So what we're proposing, and the big topic of youth mode, is kind of a mode of engagement, not this kind of understanding of like opting in or opting out, because you recognize
normcore.
It is called
normcore. That's one potential solution.
But it recognizes that you can't escape away or find out. Instead, it's more about a new mode of engagement, which is ultimately freer because it's about acceptance and not denial. And it actually addresses these mass indie problems head on and doesn't kind of run away.
So, she's normcore. A lot of what we were thinking about, and we mentioned a little bit in the isolation part, is that there's a really big issue with a mass indie cultural scenario is a feeling of isolation and loneliness. And when being cool is all about being as special and different as possible, it can be really, really difficult to have a sense of belonging.
And to not just end up completely isolated.
Right. So the way that we phrase it is that, like, once upon a time, back in the olden days, people were born into communities and had to find their individuality. And that was the process of adolescence. That was when, you know, you would steal your dad's car, crash it, wear a leather jacket,
rebel,
start a punk
cause.
Band, become an artist or something.
Get grunge.
But now, people are born individuals and need to find their communities. So it's mass indie deals with this problem by creating cliques of people in the know. So you can say like, oh, these are my people. I feel snug and warm and understood by them.
And a lot of it is about like, oh, we're speaking the same language. We're using the same terms.
We like the
same
stuff.
Wearing the same things.
We buy the same stuff. But normcore realizes that creating these sort of sealed and static cliques is not actually a good strategy. It's more about putting yourself in a lot of places where there's the potential for community to spring up. So kind of stacking the deck to make it possible for you to connect to as many different types of people as possible.
And also having it like in the know or not in the know is basically you're just like setting up terms and building more walls where it's not actual connection, it's more just kind of affinity.
But it's also not like some kumbaya free to be you and me thing where it's all about like accepting everyone, because that's just not real and would also be boring, I think. It's about recognizing that none of us are above the indignity of belonging, that belonging is hard and complicated and messy and nonlinear, and that we're going to have to come up with new strategies to make it work.
And like with your generation, you belong to your generation, whether you like it or not.
Right, instead of saying, it being this thing where it's like, I am my generation except for X, Y, and Z.
And if you're not a part of one community, you're part of another.
Getting beyond those binaries and realizing that if we think about it in a new way, there's a potential for things to get a lot cooler.
What's next?
Oh. All right. So
let's read. So these we wrote some bullet points about normcore to try and explain its flavor to you. Should we read them out loud?
Yes.
I'll
tag
okay.
Team.
Normcore is situational,
non-deterministic,
adaptable,
unconcerned with authenticity.
It puts empathy over tolerance.
And it's post-aspirational. There's no end game.
And if you look at all those things together, it's cool, I think. We think it's cool. We think that there's a potential for an interesting new mode of cultural engagement.
I think something to emphasize is that normcore, it's not about just celebrating sameness in some creepy clone way, which ends up being more of what acting basic looks like. It's more about relating, seeing kind of like Venn diagrams, relation, like how you relate to people around you, and how you can kind of like look at a situation and like figure out how you're supposed to respond to it, rather than just having this like clearly set cone of self and going.
Also, normcore is all about strategic misinterpretation. So in an older model where like I would have my truth and society would misunderstand me, society being my mom and my dad, and then I would feel misunderstood, and then I would have to go out into the world and live a life and make media and make arts that people would understand me, and then once I felt understood, everything would be great.
And that people could just not get you.
Right, when I would have crises when people didn't understand me, right? That was like, we all know what that's about. You have a crisis because somebody doesn't understand you, it's not what you meant. Normcore says, okay, let's dig into the fact that people misunderstand each other constantly and use it as a way to make life more interesting. Put yourself in situations where you're going, if you're misunderstood, that might lead to a sort of ultra opportunistic situation where you actually end up getting to be with a lot of people you might not otherwise have been able to be with.
And you might figure out that what the other person understood you saying is actually what you meant.
So one way that we like to think about it is like in terms of conversations, that casual conversations that are usually boring, but people reveal a lot about themselves in. Mass indie is like when people tell you all about their dream, whereas normcore is talking about the weather. In both cases, it can sometimes be boring and sometimes be interesting, but at the end of the day, that person's dream is their dream. There's no way you're really gonna get in there and see it, whereas the coming storms affect us all. That's normcore.
So in terms of youth mode, that's trying to deal with negotiating being special and being free and being ageless and just being vibrant, normcore finds liberation in being nothing special. So it's not, you know, it realizes that it's more about adaptability, and being nothing special kind of opens up an entirely new landscape of opportunity and connection and belonging, which is super important. So
it has a lot of ramifications for consumption, because whether you're a sneakerhead or a consumer activist, you're way over-identified with what you're buying, and you can get into situations where you become a hypocrite for buying the wrong thing. That's a mass indie model. In a normcore model, you realize that consumer choices are not irrelevant. They're just temporary. They change a lot. People are complicated. They're not all hypocrites. Just negotiating the facts on the ground means that you're going to make a lot of different choices at different times.
And I know this might feel a little bit sticky, but these things that affect your, you know, are kind of about your consumer habits, also are affecting your relationships. So the same way that, you know, this goes towards like your, how you're constructing your identity and the things that you consume, it's also kind of like opening up a new field for how you can relate to your friends. And
so basically, normcore is a path to a more peaceful life.
So in conclusion, to kind of visualize this for all of you guys, we made this semiotic square, and we have some posters over there on the table.
If you put all four of the posters together, they'll make up this square, and then you may still not understand it, but you'll have four beautiful posters. But basically, you know, alternative culture is about evading sameness and being different. Mass indie is about celebrating that sameness. Acting basic is about evading that difference and trying to get away from all the micro differentiators. And normcore celebrates sameness in an empathetic way. So you can download our report from the internet
on khole.net or box1824.com.br. And thank you.
Thanks so much.